Gentlemen, very warm welcome to St. John the Baptist Manor Park with Whitby Road, St. Michael. It's so lovely to have you here, and I know that the congregation is absolutely excited about this occasion. They've waited a very long time for an incumbent, and they are so excited about having Susan here with them. And so I'm not going to keep you very long, but just really to point out the Bishop's Outreach Fund. You will see that there is an envelope on your chair, and that's for you to make a donation if you're able to do that, and all the funds will go to the Bishop's Outreach Fund. There are information in the order of service about that. So without further ado, we're going to start the service, and please stand for our first hymn, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky. Thank you.
God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Friends, we have come together in the presence of God to welcome Suzanne to this benefice, to institute her to the ministry she will share here, to pray for Suzanne and for those who minister with her as we dedicate ourselves afresh to the service of God in this community, to the call which he makes on each one of us. Let us therefore wait humbly upon God, giving thanks for all that he has done and asking forgiveness for those ways in which we have failed each other, our communities, and our God. Lord Jesus, you said to your disciples, You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. Lord, have mercy. Lord Jesus, we know that the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Christ, have mercy. Lord Jesus, you appointed us to go out and bear fruit that will last. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May the God of love bring you back to himself, forgive you your sins, and assure you of his eternal love in Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Tim. I'm a Canon Christchurch people of Oxford. One of the patrons and my colleagues from Eton College, no less, is the other patron. How's that for establishment? Really good, isn't it? In the old days, a patron was responsible for providing a priest and nominating them, but they had to pay them as well. Now, I'm afraid that's a good try and look after some kids and look on very briefly. And do you remember in Sunday school we used to hear about bricks without straw? You know, the Jews had to make bricks and they couldn't do their job. Two things new vicars need. First of all, is being allowed to do their job. Sometimes people have got very defensive about their tasks, saying, I do this, just stay over there. Now, give her a break. On the other hand, some people would say, right, we've done all the work during the interregnum, over to you, we're off. Please don't do that. Please encourage that very, very much. And God bless you. Okay, would you like to join me in front? To you about the Reverend Father in God, after due consultation and prayerful consideration, Suzanne Johnson has been nominated and has accepted to be vicar of this benefice. I now present you to her to you to be instituted and inducted.
Sandra, Tim, I thank you and all those who with much prayer have been involved in the appointment of Suzanne to this benefice. Suzanne, do you believe, so far as you know your own heart, that God has called you to serve him?
I believe that God has called me.
Will you commit yourself to the mission and ministry of the people of God in this place to further the kingdom of God?
With the help of God, I will.
I'm going to invite those who share most closely in ministry with Suzanne, the ministry team, as it were, to step forward at this point, because I have a question for you. We share together as colleagues in ministry. It's how Jesus worked. He didn't recruit lots of superheroes. He recruited a community of love and of faith and sent them out two by two, actually. There was always a dimension of community around. Members of this leadership team, will you welcome Suzanne to your team to work creatively and faithfully with her, meeting regularly for prayer, for study, and for fellowship, and doing all in your power to support each other in fulfilling the ministry of Christ? As you are able, please stand. Various important promises have been made, and now it's your turn. People of God, will you welcome Suzanne and support and uphold her in her ministry here, now and in the years to come? As we stand, let us commit all that is to be to God's grace, to God's spirit, and to God's peace. God, our Father, Lord of all the world, through your Son, you have called us into the fellowship of your universal church. Hear our prayer for your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry, each may be an instrument of your love. and give to your servant Suzanne, now to be blessed, the needful gifts of your grace. Through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Sit to listen for God's word.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel, Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call, my son. Lie down again." Now Samuel did not know the Lord yet, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called again, a third time. And he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli, perceiving that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle reading is taken from the letter to the Ephesians. "So, he came and proclaimed peace to you who are far off, and peace to those who are near. For through him, both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints, and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together, spiritually, into a dwelling place for God." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In longing for life, we wait in darkness. Christ be our Lord.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Do please be seated. So Suzanne, formal welcome, the warmest of welcomes to you as you take this exciting next step in your life and also in the life of St. John and St. Michael and in the life of this community here. Warm welcome to Mark also. I am grateful to you both for hearing God's invitation to come here among us, to be part of what God is doing and will do in this place. This has been an extraordinary difficult time for the church here. A long and challenging vacancy, compounded by COVID. But this now is a moment of a new beginning, a fresh start. I am truly excited by the real rebuilding opportunities that may now lie ahead. There's the strengthening and development of the local church here through mission and ministry. There's the pastoring and teaching, that developing of the deeper community engagement right across the parish. And then, of course, we have the exciting rebuilding of this physical church building. This is a significant and exciting point. And Suzanne, I'm delighted that you have been called here at this time to lead this church forward. And alongside the many members of the church here and family and friends who have gathered to support you today, it's good to be able to welcome other particular people from the community. Tan Desai, thank you very much. Our local MP, lovely that you're here to support, and also local councillors, Fasa Matlu and Carmeljit Kaur, thank you both for being here, representing the community at this moment. Thank you to everyone for being here to support Suzanne and Mark, St. John's and St. Michael's as they begin this new chapter. Not least, of course, thank you to those who kept things going during the vacancy, church wardens, but other members of the clergy who've been here supporting things. I want to ask you all today to commit yourself to encouraging and supporting and praying and working together with Suzanne as she and you build together God's kingdom here in this place. The readings that were chosen for this evening, Suzanne chose them. They are the call and response of Samuel and Jesus's invitation to come and find rest for your soul. Both of them are quite personal to Suzanne as part of her call to ordained ministry and to service. But they also challenge us about our listening, the call of God on our lives, and our need to discover in Jesus the perfect rest that he provides for our weary souls. But it is the epistle reading, Paul's letter to the Ephesians, that I want to just focus on for a moment this evening. As I mentioned, one of the tasks that lie ahead, no small task, is the physical rebuilding of this church with a new building. So it seemed appropriate to remind ourselves that God is in the building business, and he invites us to build on him, to build ourselves in him, and to be built with him. So just as we come to this reading from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, let's pray. So we ask now, O God, that you would open our ears to hear your words and to know your voice, that you would speak to our hearts and strengthen our wills, that we may serve you now and always. Amen. Now, if you follow the news, it won't have escaped your attention that a certain former Russian Soviet leader died this last week, Mikhail Gorbachev. And at least one of the things that he will be remembered for is helping to bring an end to the Cold War. He died last week, age 91. He came to power in 1985, and he introduced reforms that opened up the Soviet Union to the world and paved the way for a peaceful end to the Cold War. He was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 1990 for the role that he played. tempted to say something like how times change, but how we desperately need today peacemakers and peacekeepers, and we should pray for those. But the key symbol, it seemed to me, of the Cold War was the Berlin Wall. You know, gun turrets and barbed wire, but it divided the communist East Germany from the democratic West. And I vividly remember watching on TV the tearing down of that wall in November 1989 and the reuniting of East and West Germany. It was a symbol of the ending of the Cold War. And it's one of those things that I think for me is unlikely ever to be forgotten. If you traveled to Jerusalem in the time of the Apostle Paul, then you would have found other walls, not the walls of Jerusalem, you know, the local ice cream seller. And I'm not thinking of those fortified walls that surrounded the city. I'm thinking about the wall that surrounded the temple, the presence of God amongst his people. It divided the outer court, the court of Gentiles, from the inner courts, where no Gentile was allowed to enter. And further inside, there was another wall that beyond which no women were permitted to enter. And further on, another barrier that kept everybody out except the high priest. And then only he could enter on one day. The temple represented God's presence and yet seemed full of walls and barriers that said this far and no further. And when Jesus died on the cross, the veil, that last barrier, was torn in two, and it symbolized that God was breaking down barriers and building something new. Paul was writing to the mainly Gentile church in Ephesus, reminding them that they once were outside. They were without Christ. They were without citizenship. They were without God's covenant promises. They had no hope. They were excluded from the community of God's people, behind a wall that said this far and no further. And Paul says, remember what you once were. And we all need to remember what we once were. At some points, perhaps we still are strangers to God. We are all offered forgiveness in his kingdom. Sin separates us from God, and there is no way for us to change that. Paul referred to that as being like strangers and aliens. Both seem to refer to those who are not part of the resident population. They have little or no rights, this far, but no further. All of us were at one point separated from God, but that was then. And this is now. Because of Jesus' death, because of his burial and resurrection, those who believe in Jesus are reconciled to God. And we who once were far away are brought near into his presence. No one is a natural born citizen in the kingdom of God, but God provides a path in Jesus to full citizenship. Those who are now in Christ are no longer strangers and aliens. They're fellow citizens together in the kingdom of God, with all the rights, with all the privileges, with all the protections that those outside, foreigners, don't have. Ephesians 2 and verse 4, just before our reading. Because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. You see, God intervened. God changed everything. We were dead, but now we are alive because of his love, because of his mercy, because of his grace and his kindness. Our situation has been changed forever. God, the builder, has removed the barriers. He has removed the divided walls because he is in the building business, and he invites us to come and be built into him, to be builders with him. And Paul says, remember what you once were. Remember the greatness of God's grace and mercy that transform you, and your past changes it forever. You who once were at distance are now brought near. And we're not brought near through some vague notion that God loves us, but through all that Jesus did through his death on the cross, which we shall remember as we celebrate communion. We can come because God gave himself for us in Jesus. He himself is our peace. He himself has recognized and reconciled us. He is our peacemaker, and in him that dividing wall is broken down. But God is not just in the demolition business, as it were. God is a builder. And now, and this is the exciting bit, he has made the two one. We are entirely built anew. Something has come into existence that didn't exist before. Out of Jews and Gentiles, God has built one family of people, one glorious thing called the church, his great creation. I do hope you love the church, because it's God's grand design par excellence. You ought to, because it means a great deal to him. He gave himself for it. Jesus died for the church. He loves the church. And so whatever your backgrounds, whether you know, whatever differences there are, large or small, we are a new people with all the barriers demolished. We are a new thing together, a new build, a newly built humanity in Christ, founded on the apostles and the prophets and all that has gone faithfully before us, with our Lord Jesus Christ as the chief cornerstone. He holds everything together. And if you are in Christ, you are part of that building. You are fitted together with me and Suzanne and with all the church. We are God's building. God is the builder. And not just any old building, a temple, a place where God is present and where God is met. And what matters in heaven, what really matters on earth, what matters now is that we are this new humanity, this new build, living demonstration that Christ brings us together in reconciliation. No one, you know, whatever their background, has an automatic right of access. We are there because of the grace of God. And we are there together as God's new build. We are no longer without. And perhaps that's a sort of phrase we need to write on a t-shirt somewhere. Things are different now. No longer aliens or strangers, no longer apart. We are together. We belong together in the household of God, built together as fellow members of the family of God. And fellow members of the family of God, we build and grow together, not least here in Manor Park. And it is this building of people that truly counts, not the place where we meet, as I'm sure you know. St. John's and St. Michael's are two congregations that have come together with a great new building project to replace this building, a building that has faithfully served for decades. But it's my hope and prayer that when St. John's and St. Michael's are talked about, it won't be just about the building. It will be about the people that have been talked about, a people who are different, a people who act differently, who belong together, who work together, who build together as the family of God, a place where God dwells by his Holy Spirit. God is a master builder, and he is building something wonderful. And I am convinced that God will build something wonderful here. It's called the church. He has laid the foundation. He has placed the cornerstone. He has assembled living stones into his structure, and he adds more and more. He is equipping and using us in his building work. I commend Suzanne to you, and I invite you to be part of what God is building now here in this place. We pray. Father God, we pray now that you would help us to be part of this new humanity, to live it, to proclaim it, to pray for it, that things might be different. Help us to remember what we were before Christ reached out to us and found us. Help us to be those new people who love, who forgive, who care, who support one another, who reach out to others in need. Help us to be reconciled to you and to one another as a living demonstration of your love and grace. Thank you that we are at the heart of your vision for the world. You are committed to building a church. Thank you that you are committed to building your church here in Manor Park. And thank you most of all that you are committed to each one of us. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, Chris. And now representatives from the church will bring forward some symbols of ministry for Suzanne. Gracious God, we praise and glorify you because in your infinite love, you have formed throughout the world a holy people for your own possession, a royal priesthood, a universal church, that sharing the ministry of our Saviour Christ, we may be witnesses of what he has done for us. Gracious God, we praise and glorify you.
Suzanne, be among us as a woman who rejoices to bring new Christians to baptism and to share with them the living water, Jesus Christ himself.
Suzanne, be among us as a woman of reconciliation, showing God's forgiveness and healing. Together, Suzanne, be among us as a woman who studies the scriptures, proclaims the word, and explores the faith.
Suzanne, be among us as a woman of prayer, offering the church's liturgy and interceding for God's people.
Together, by God's grace, we will worship God, Spirit, and
Suzanne, be among us as a woman of the Eucharist, presiding among us when we celebrate the Lord's death and resurrection.
I pledge myself to care for the community that gathers here, to share with them the word of God and the work of ministry, to celebrate with them the sacrament of the new covenant, and to encourage them in their discipleship, Together, may we make this a place where Christian people are equipped for their life and witness in God's world.
Amen. So we come to the legal bit, the formal bit. There are three promises involved. The first locates Susan within the life and ministry of the Church of England. Talks about the story that's brought us here, the scriptures, the life of faith and discipleship that she represents in this wonderful community. And she commits herself to represent that faithfully and truthfully and lovingly and openly. And then the Queen comes in. What this says is that Suzanne's ministry relates to all of society, not just the people who come, but anybody who needs the love and grace and help that can come to them through this community. It's a very high priority. And it's not about the people who come like a golf club or something like that, with all due apologies to any golf clubs. It's about all of society and everybody who may be in need of God's love and affirmation, whatever their creed or distinguishing characteristics, God is here for everybody. And then finally, my favorite one, which is all about obedience to bishops. If I were a lazy man, I'd have 300 clergy and I could sort of order them to do all the things I'm too lazy to do. Couldn't just pop down to the paper shop, and then get cut. This doesn't actually mean, it's not about Simon Says, and it's not the kind of obedience, it's just about shouting at people and asserting yourself. Jesus isn't like that, and neither should we ever be like that with anybody. Some people say that word obedience really means listening. Listening not just with your ears, but also with your heart. Being open to listen to one another in a ministry that together we share in this very special place, Suzanne. And it's my custom to say to people when we do these legal oaths, I need to be as accountable to you as you are to me. It's a two-way street, because above all, we are brother and sister in Christ. Whatever else we can say, things we need to do through the structure of the church. We represent Jesus, not the scribes and Pharisees. And it's a reminder to me and to you that that's the case. It's a kingdom of love we're building, not an organization that's there for its own benefit. So starting at the beginning, the Church of England is part of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, worshipping the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It professes the faith, uniquely revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, which faith the Church is called upon to proclaim afresh in each generation. Led by the Holy Spirit, it has borne witness to Christian truth in its historic formulas, the 39 Articles of Religion, the Book of Common Prayer, and the ordering of bishops, priests, and deacons. In the declaration you are about to make, please, will you affirm your loyalty to this inheritance of faith as your inspiration and guidance under God in bringing the grace and truth of Christ to this generation and making him known to those within your care?
I, Suzanne Joan Johnson, do so affirm and accordingly declare my belief in the faith which is revealed in the Holy Scriptures and set forth in the Catholic creeds, and to which the historic formularies of the Church of England bear witness. And in public prayer and administration of the sacraments, I will use only the forms of service which are authorised or allowed by canon.
Okay,
Suzanne, I, Suzanne Joan Johnson, do swear that I will be faithful and bear true allegiance to Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, her heirs and successors, according to law. So help me God. I, Suzanne Joan Johnson, do swear by Almighty God that I will pay true and canonical obedience to the Lord Bishop of Oxford
and his successors, and through his delegation to the Bishop of Buckingham in all things lawful and honest. So help me God.
As you are able, please stand. This deed witnesses the lawful basis of Suzanne's ministry in this benefice. We, Alan Thomas Lawrence, Bishop Suffragan of Buckingham, hereby institute you, Suzanne Joan Johnson, Clerk in Holy Orders, to the benefice of Manor Park, St. John the Baptist, and Whitby Road, St. Michael, in the Archdeaconry of Buckingham and Diocese of Oxford, to which you are presented to us by the Provost of the College Royal of the Blessed Mary of Eton, near unto Windsor in the County of Buckinghamshire, commonly called the King's College of Our Blessed Lady at Eton, and the Dean and Canons of the Cathedral Church of Christ in Oxford of the foundation of King Henry VIII. We invest you with all rights and duties and benefits, and we commit unto you the cure of souls of the parishioners thereon, saving only to ourselves and to the Bishop of Oxford and to our successors our episcopal rights. In witness of which, the episcopal seal of the Bishop of Oxford is affixed to this deed, and we have subscribed the same this fourth day of September in the year of our Lord 2022. Suzanne, receive this cure of souls, which is both yours and mine. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So we turn to prayer, and the first thing that happens is I anoint. This is a sign in the scriptures of being called by God to a particular ministry that is special, for which he will resource you. Suzanne, remember your baptism into Christ. Remember your ordination in the Church of God. God, who anointed the Lord Jesus Christ with the Holy Spirit at his baptism, anoint and empower you for the blessing of God's people. And invite the ministry team to join Suzanne as together we seek that blessing for them in the life and the work they share together. The God of all peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working within you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. In the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Chris, dear brother, I have instituted Suzanne to the cure of souls and this benefice. I ask you, please, to induct her in the presence of this congregation and to support and protect her in her ministry in this place. Suzanne, by virtue of the authority given me, I induct you into the real, actual, and corporeal possession of the Church of Manor Park to John the Baptist, with all the rights and responsibilities belonging to them.
And may the Lord preserve your going out and your coming.
Suzanne, I install you as vicar of this benefice. Pray for your people. Lead them in worship and service, and encourage them in their witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. People of this benefice, I present to you Suzanne as your new vicar, now duly instituted, inducted, and installed. I invite you to greet her in the name of Christ, and I commend her most warmly to your love and to your prayers. We welcome you. May the Lord richly bless you, and make you bless you. We are the body of Christ and the one Spirit. We were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common love. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Ron, what happens next? Because with me around, there's always going to be trouble. Janice, people, you're welcome to your next.
So at this point in the service, we are going to welcome Suzanne to this deanery. But of course, that's really an informality because Suzanne has always been a part of this deanery. We know that Suzanne, where her heart is really in the community. And we know and suspect that this year will continue as she takes up this role. So Suzanne, thank you so much for all that you've been doing already this evening. And I'm really looking forward to working with you. We already mentioned the rebuilding of this church, and that's going to be a major project. And we're all behind you. We're all here to support the work that God has called you to. So always shout if you need some help. There's lots of us here. I know there'll be lots of food that we're going to be partaking in, but it doesn't end there. We're all going to be involved in the work of rebuilding this church, not just the building, but rebuilding God's church, us as the people of God. So I'm going to hand over to our lay chair, who's going to say a few words to David.
Dear Suzanne, as lay chair of our deanery, it's with great pleasure to congratulate you and formally welcome you, not into the deanery on this occasion, but into St John's, Manor Park, and St Michael, Whitby Road. You're not a new face. I don't mean you've got the old face. But you're already well known to many of us within the deanery. Especially to me when you were a licensed lay minister at St Thomas in Colebrook and St Mary's in Detchet for many years. And so we're all done and pleased to see you installed here today as the new vicar. I know it's been a long journey for you, and we know you have not been the most patient person. You know what they say, patience is virtue. But it was meant to be, and so culminating in God calling you to be at this parish here today. Suzanne, I wish you the very best for the future. May God go with you.
Thank you. Now, MP, time to say a few words.
May I say, normally have that sort of effect. not when I'm standing on the floor of the house. But may I say, as a member of Parliament for Slough, it is an absolute honour and a privilege to welcome back the Bishop of Buckingham, as well as the Associate Archdeacon of Buckingham, back to Slough. And thank you very much for presiding over the institution, the induction and installation of Reverend Suzanne as the vicar of the local benefice head. Well, Suzanne, as has been very rightly pointed out, you are an old face in the community. In the most delightful way. We are very much looking forward to working with you. I know that there are many councillors in our midst today, Councillor Paul, Councillor Brooker, Councillor McBloom, and also, given our diverse community, it's also wonderful to see heads of various different multi-faith places of worship that are also here, along with the wider congregation. And we all know that in Slough, we are not without our problems. While Slough is a thriving place, it is the youth capital of Britain, no less. We are a huge business hub, a huge cultural hub, but we also have issues, whether it's with regards to some areas of social deprivation. We need to work together for the betterment of all, for the upliftment of all, as indeed the church and the Bible instructs all followers to do. But as the duly elected member of Parliament for Slough, I look forward to working with you for the betterment of the whole community. And absolutely, it is an honour, Suzanne, that you are here as the vicar of your local community. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And I'd like to ask Councillor Preston to come forward and say a few words.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to annoy my scriptwriter and put my script in my inside pocket. I've done that regularly because I often read the script and then think, oh, I've had the privilege of working with Suzanne already. We've done funerals, we've worked with the Visual Foundation, and I'm looking forward to the changes you will bring forward to this church. I drive past his church nearly every day because I live on the brick wall and I work in town, as I'm sure you know. I've known Suzanne for only a short time, but in that short time, I've seen she's a wonderful person, and I'm sure you are going to be a wonderful asset to this community. Welcome to Scotland, welcome to this community. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. And I'd like to ask Mark and Rachel to come forward. So Rachel is part of a Spicer, the funeral directors, and Mark is working with Suzanne on the community cafe.
I first met Suzanne and Mark about 16 years ago when I was living and working in West Drayton as an older person's outreach worker. I met them at church. They're very much involved in the local community. And to be honest with you, it's been lovely to witness God's plan for them both unfold, bringing them to this wonderful community of Manor Park. Aside from being a friend, I'm also the founder of a local group called the Slough Community Support Cafe. And I'm extremely grateful to Suzanne, the PCC, and the Congregation of St John's for making this the first location in Slough in which one of the support cafes will operate. The church truly has an outward-looking approach, reaching out and helping the local community in these times of desperate need. Suzanne and Mark, I welcome you to Slough, to Manor Park, and to St John's.
I'm a close friend of Suzanne and Mark, and I'm also the funeral director for A. Spicer and Sons, based on the Farm Road. I went into the funeral business to help people at that time of great need. And I know that Suzanne and the people of St John's will be able to provide much needed comfort and support to the bereaved in the local community. I welcome you, Suzanne and Mark, to St John's.
So thank you everyone for your encouragement and for your support, which I'm sure that Suzanne will receive throughout her ministry here at Manor Park in Wicker Road. And so please stand now as we sing our next hymn, Beauty for Brokenness.
It's God's glory.
These gifts and our hearts in your service through Christ our Lord. Blessed be God who feeds the hungry, who raises the poor, who fills our prayers.
Blessed be God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks.
You are worthy of our thanks and praise, Lord God of truth, for by the breath of your mouth you have spoken your word, and all things have come into being. You fashioned us in your image and placed us in the garden of your delight. Though we chose the path of rebellion, you would not abandon your own. Again and again you drew us into your covenant of grace. You gave your people the law and taught us by your prophets to look for your reign of justice, mercy, and peace. As we watch for the signs of your kingdom on earth, we echo the song of the angels in heaven, evermore praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Lord God, you are the most holy one, enthroned in splendor and light. Yet in the coming of your Son, Jesus Christ, you reveal the power of your love, made perfect in our human weakness. Embracing our humanity, Jesus showed us the way of salvation, loving us to the end. He gave himself to death for us, dying for his own. He set us free from the bonds of death and sin, that we might rise and reign with him in glory. On the night he gave up himself for us all, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, drink this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Therefore, we proclaim the death that he suffered on the cross. We celebrate his resurrection, his bursting from the tomb. We rejoice that he reigns at your right hand on high, and we long for his coming in glory. As we recall the one perfect sacrifice of our redemption, Father, by your Holy Spirit, let these gifts of your creation be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Form us into the likeness of Christ, and make us a perfect offering in your sight. Look with favor on your people, and in your mercy hear the cry of our hearts. Bless the earth, heal the sick, and let the oppressed go free, and fill your church with power from on high. Gather your people from the ends of the earth to feast with St. John, St. Michael, and all your saints at the table in your kingdom, where the new creation is brought to perfection in Jesus Christ, our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us pray with confidence, as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, we break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Lamb of God, you take
away.
Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your heart, by faith, with thanksgiving.
Thank you. Thank you.
Let us thank God together for his gift. Almighty God,
we thank you for giving us the Lord, who is the Son, the Spirit, for the living God, who loves souls and hearts, to be able to inside of us, set us out to be out of this truth, to be able to
Amen. God, our Father, shepherd and guide of all your people, look with favour on your servant Suzanne, whom you have chosen to be a pastor in your church. Grant that by word and example, she may lead the people committed to her charge, and with them come to your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I have to give out the notices now. Next Sunday at 10 a.m. there will be a service in this church. In fact, there will be a service every Sunday at 10 a.m. in this church. So if you feel so inclined, do pop down and join us. You can hold the walls up. Yeah, we need pictures of that. Sunday the 25th of September is the celebration of St. Michael's Day. And there will be a shindig afterwards. So do come. Lenny will make the tea. She makes the best tea in Slough. So do come down and join us for that if you are able. I would like to thank all those who've worked so hard, and you all know who you are, who've worked really hard in making this place presentable for the day. We don't have cobwebs. We do have a nice painted white wall. Thank you, Digger and Katie. And we have lovely refreshments in there. So I do thank you all so very much for all your hard work and everything that you've put into making today so special for all of us here. You know, by now we have plans to build a new church building in the new year, and not a day till soon. And of course, you've had a collection today for the Bishop's Outreach Fund, but here comes the vicar. If you would like to make a donation towards our building fund, there is a tray as you go through to the church hall for refreshments. And we're not proud. Large banknotes, checks, anything. We'll take anything. We don't mind. But please do go through to the church hall. And I bet you're all desperate to get some refreshments, as I'm sure you all are. I am. But do bring them back into here or go outside and move the chairs and make yourselves feel comfortable. God placed us here to do his work and serve this community. And I've spoken at length to both our local councillors about our perception of the needs of this community. And boy, are they sorry they've given me their mobile phone number. The next step is to ask the community what they think they need. And then the fun begins. The devil has worked hard to put the kibosh on the mission and ministry in this place. But my friends, we are not going to let him win. We are going to let them know that the Christians are at home, and we are going to rock Manor up. Oh, that's the blessing.
I'm famous for saying if Jesus Christ is risen, everything else is rock and roll. As you're able, please stand. And let's bow our heads and ask for God's blessing on this wonderful community, on all of our friends, whoever they may be, and on a world of need. And that we may be part of his blessing and healing of this broken world. Almighty God, who for the salvation of the world gives to his people many gifts and ministries to the advancement of his glory, stir up within you the gifts of his grace and sustain each one of you in your own ministry. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you.
Amen.
Thine be the glory, risen conqueror.
Thank you.